Good morning students. Today we'll discuss about data mining concepts and techniques. Last class continuations. In the last class we have discussed about apiary algorithms, the working principles with an examples. Today we'll see how to improve the efficiency of apiary algorithms. So before that we'll see the apiary algorithm. A priori algorithm is a classical algorithm in data mining. A priori algorithm is an influential algorithm for mining frequent item set for Boolean association rule. It is used for mining frequent item sets and relevant association rules. It uses a prior knowledge of frequent item set properties. It uses k frequent item sets to find k plus 1 item sets. It is devised to operate on database containing a lot of transactions, for instance items bought by customer in a store. It is also based on three concepts. One is frequent item set, then a priori property and join operations. The major disadvantages of a priori algorithm is requires many database scan. Here we'll scan our database many times. And the other one is assumes a transaction database is memory resistant. We are always here assumes a transaction database is memory resistant. So because of these two disadvantages, we have to improve the a priori algorithms. So to improve the efficiency of a priori algorithms, there are few methods. First one is hash based technique, then transaction reductions, then partitioning, then dynamic item set counting, then sampling. The first method we'll see hash based techniques. In hash-based table technique, hash table is used as a data structure. Okay. In first iteration, it is required to count support of each item set. In second iteration, the efforts are made to enhance execution of a priori by utilizing hash table concepts. Okay. So, hash table minimizes the number of items generated in a second iterations. This will help to improve the efficiency of the algorithms, a priori algorithm. In second iterations, two items are generated for every combinations of two items. We map them into diverse bucket of hash table structure and increment the bucket count. Okay. So if the count of bucket is less than minimum support count, we remove them from data sets. Candidate sets. Okay. These are all the procedure which is going to be implemented in hash table technique. So with an example we'll see hash table technique. Now we'll see the first table. Here we have transaction ID and list of IDs. This is the first database, first table. It's a database table. Here we have number of items. For each and every items item set we have transaction ID. For example, T1 transaction having item sets I1, I2, I5. T2 transaction having items I2, I4. T3 transaction ID having item set I2, I3. T4 transaction ID having item set I1. I1, I3, like that we have T9. Okay. So this is a basic database. The basic database, it is a minimum support count is 3. Okay. Minimum support count is 3. And this is going to be converted into C1 table by here in C1 table we are going to take all item set individually and we'll find support count for each and every item. For example, I1 6 times is occurred in base tables. I2 7 times is occurred in the base table. And I3 6 times, I4 2 times, I5 2 times. Okay, these are all support count. So which is taken from base tables. Next, the hash function is going to be implemented. So before going for hash function, we must know the order. The order of item, it is given the down. Okay. Order of item equal to I1 equal to 1, I2 equal to 2, I3 equal to 3, I4 equal to 4, and I5 equal to 5. This is the order. It should be maintained over here. I1, I2, I3, I4, I5. And then. And minimum support count is 3. So hash function will be implemented with the help of the formula. It is nothing but hx of y equal to order of first into 10 plus order of second into mod 7. And the 7 is nothing but prime number. Now we will go for the hash function. Here we have three columns, like first column is item set, then count, then hash function. In the item set, we have taken two items. Okay, so in the C1 we have single items like I1, I2, I3, I4, I5. All the possible combinations with two items will be found, and it will be placed in the hash functions. Like I1, I2, I1, I3, I1, I4, I1, I5, I2, I3, I2, I4, I2, I5, I3, I4, I3, I5, I4, I5. So these are all the possible combinations of two item set, which is taken from item set in C1. Again, next, the item set I1, I2, how many times occurred in base table? Okay. It is 4 times. For example, I1, I2 in the database, here we can see T1. In T1 it is occurred, and in T4 it is occurred, then T8 it is occurred, then T9 it is occurred. So totally 4 times it is occurred in the database. So the count is 4. Again, I1, I3. The I1, I3 in the database, it is occurred 4 times. With the same combination, it is occurred in database 4 times. So the count is 4 over here. Then I1, I4 1 time. I1, I5 2 times. I2, I3 4 times. I2, I4 2 times. I2, I5 2 times. Then I3, I4, there is no combination in the database, so it is 0. Then I3, I5, it is occurring 1 time, so the count is 1. I4, I5, okay, there is no combinations in the database, so the count is 0. Now, we will apply hash function. Hash function formula is given here. Order of first, that is, order of first is nothing but the item set. We have two items. The first item will be taken, then into 10 plus order of second. The second item will be taken here. So the first item order number is, okay, in the down we are given order of items. Okay, so order of item I1 equal to 1, okay, I2 equal to 2. Okay, the down we have given order of items. Okay, the same value will be presented over in the table. Okay, in the hash function table, here we can take first one, I1, I2, count is 4. The hash function is 1. 1 is nothing but I1 value in order. Okay, it is given. It is the order of first one. Then into 10 formula plus 2. 2 is nothing but the second order item. Okay, the value is given down. It is a 2. So that will be given over here. Okay, then mod 7 equal to 5. So if you find the value for 1 into 10 plus 2 into mod 7, then the value will be 5. The same way, we'll see in the other one, I1, I3. For I1, I3, the count is 4. Then the hash function is, I1 is the first number, first order, that value is 1, is given over here. Int in the 10, it is given in the formula, plus second order, that is nothing but I3. I3 in the order, the value is 3. So 3 is given over here, okay, into mod 7. So the value is 6. Okay. Same way, we'll find all other also. Okay. And here you can see the mod value is nothing but bucket numbers. Okay. So bucket number, now we'll tell 5, 6, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4 and 0. Okay. These are all the bucket values. Okay. In this bucket, so in each and every bucket we have a count. So we can take another way. In bucket 5 we have count 4. In bucket 6 we have count 4. In bucket 0 we have count 1. Okay. Here we have two bucket zeros. See here, count 1, okay, having 0, and the last I3, I5, okay, here also the bucket is 0. So for bucket 0, okay, the count will be 2, okay, here is 1, here is another 1, okay. So if you see the sum, it is a 2, okay, so in bucket 0, the count will be 2, okay, so the same thing will be, we'll present the other table. Okay. Hash table structure to generate L2. Here we can see, okay, bucket address, bucket count, bucket content, and the L2. Okay. So here, bucket address is, we told you already, we through hash function, we found the bucket address. So they are all in order, if you put 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay, in each and every bucket, the value, the count value we have to place over here. This for 0 bucket, we have count is 2. For 1 first bucket, we have count 2. For second bucket, we have count 4. For third bucket, we have count 2. And fourth bucket, we have count 2. And fifth bucket, 4. And sixth bucket, 4. Okay. The corresponding bucket content also, we have to find, which is taken from hash function table. Okay. So straight away we'll take it to form here. See there, in the bucket 0, we have two item set. Okay. One is I1, I4, that count is 1. The other one is I3, I5, that count is 1. If you see the sum of count, that will be 2. That is placed in the bucket count. The same way for bucket 1, the count, the bucket content will be I1, I5. That value will be 2. That is a count. Okay. And same way for bucket 2, okay, the content will be I2, I3 item set. That is, count will be 4. Okay. That is placed in the bucket count. Okay. The same way for I3. In I3 bucket, the item set is I2, I4. That value is 2. Then bucket 4, I2, I5. The value is 2. Then I5, the bucket, the content will be I1, I2. That value will be 4. The same way for 6th bucket, okay, the I2, I3, the value will be 4. Okay. These values were taken from hash function tables. Okay. From this, we have seen here minimum support count is taken 3. Okay. Now we will compare this minimum support count with these values. Okay. So the condition is, the value, the bucket count must be greater than or equal to, okay, minimum support. Here we can see, for 0 bucket, bucket 0 we have 2. Okay. Bucket 1 we have 2. Okay. Bucket 3 we have 2. Bucket 4 we have 2. All these values were, okay, less than minimum support. So this red color we have identified over here. All these values are less than minimum support. Why? Because minimum support is 3. So these collars must be removed. This bucket must be removed. The remaining will be taken care. Okay. So here we have bucket 2, bucket 2, bucket 5, and bucket 6. So drastically we reduced the process scan of the database. The advantage of this ASPER technique is reduce the number of scans. Okay. Another one is remove the large candidate that cause high input output cost. This is the ASPER techniques. So the final table is bucket address, okay, 2, 4 and 5 and 6. Sorry, 2, 5 and 6. Okay. So the removed buckets were 0, 1, 3, 4, identified in red colors. Why? Because these values are less than minimum support. Minimum support is already we assume it is 3. Okay. So these values will be removed. You have taken only bucket 2, 5, 6. That's the final. Okay. So based on this, the L2 we have represented over here. We have written over here. Okay. So zero bucket, no, we are not going to take. And first bucket, no, we are not going to take. And second bucket, yes, we will take. And third bucket, we won't take. Okay. And fourth bucket, we won't take. And fifth bucket, we will take. And sixth bucket, we will take. So yes, yes. Okay. So L2, which bucket we are going to take, that is given in the L2. So this is the ASPER technique. Through this ASPER technique, will improve the a priori algorithms. So by reducing the number of scan. Next method is transaction reductions methods. That the transaction that does not contain any frequent k item sets cannot contain any frequent k plus 1 item set. Okay. The same thing we are going to implement over here. Okay. Therefore, such a transaction can be marked or removed from the further considerations. Here we can take the base table transaction. First table is a base table. The base table, we have number of transaction. For each and every transaction, we have ID T1, T2, T3, T4. These are all transaction ID. For each and every transaction ID, we have item set. Okay. For example, for T1, we have I1, I2, I5. T2, we have I2, I3, I4. T3, we have I3, I4. T4, we have I1, I2, I3, I4. Okay. So like that, all the transaction, we have different item sets. So this can be converted into Boolean expressions. Like you can take the item set is given in the top, the transaction is given in the left side. Okay, so in the second table, the items are given in the top of the table, the transaction IDs are given in the left of the table. So in between, we'll verify the I1 item. How many times presented in T1? I2 items, how many times presented in T1? I3, how many times occurred in T1? I4, how many times occurred in T1? I5, how many times occurred in T1? Okay, so that occurring will be given in the tables. For example, we can take I1. I1 in the base table, in T1 it is occurred only one time, so it is given 1. Okay. In I2 it is occurred only one time in T1, and T3 there is no T3 in T, sorry, I3 there is no I3 in T1, and there is no I4 in T1, and I5 is available in T1 one time, that is 1 is given. Okay. The same way we can see other one. I1, where it is presented in T2 transaction, no. So we are putting 0 here. I2, where it is presented in T2 or not, yes. I2 is presented in T2. So we put 1. Okay. Same way, I3 also presented in T2, so we put 1. I4 also presented in T2, okay. So we put 1. Okay. There is no I5 in T2, so we marked 0. Okay. And in the same way for T3. In T3, I1 is not presented, so we marked 0. In T3, I2 is not presented, so we marked 0. So like that, okay. So this full table is marked. From this table, you can see the sum. Okay. The sum here, if you take T1 having 3. Okay. See I1 1, I2 1 and I5 1. If you see the sum, it is coming 3. Okay. If you see the T2 sum, it is coming 3. If you see the T3 sum, it is coming 2. And T4, it is having 4. Okay. For example, in T4, I1 is presented, I2 presented, I3 also presented, I4 also presented. So the sum will be for T4 is 4. Now, if you take item wise, if you find the sum, T1 have 2 sum, 2. The sum of the I1 is 2. So if you compare this sum with minimum support, it is equal. So I1 will be considered. And same way, I2, it is presented in T1 and T2 as well as T4. So the total, the sum will be 3. If you compare this 3 with the minimum count, it is greater than minimum support. So it will be considered. The same way, I3, if you take 0, 1, 1, 1, the sum will be 3. Okay. So if you take the 3, then it is greater than minimum support count. So it will be considered. Same way, I4 also, we are getting 3. Okay. 1, 1, 1. Okay. So I4 also will be considered. Why? Because it is greater than minimum support count too. Okay. But in case of I5, we have only 1. Okay. It is presented only in T1. So this is less than minimum support count. So the I5 will be removed. In the next table, we have given clearly I5 is marked as, is colored in red. So the I5 will be removed. The remaining values will be taken. Okay. That is presented in the other table. Okay. So now we reduced the table. So next, the same way we'll find another table. It is a transaction ID and items. The base table we have taken here. Okay. From this table again, we'll go for 2 item set. So initially, okay, here we have taken only one item set. I1, I2, I3, I4, I5. Now the same way we'll take 2 item set. Here we have taken I1, I2, I1, I3, I1, I4, then I2, I3, okay, the second table, I am reading the second table, I2, I3, I2, I4, I3, I4, okay. So in the second table, we have taken 2 item sets, okay. Now we can see the combination which is present in different transactions. If you take I1, I2, okay, I1, I2, whether it is presented in T1 or not, okay. It is the base table we are going to verify. In the base table, in T1, we have I1, I2. So, in the second table, we marked 1. So, in T1, I1, I2 is presented. So, we marked 1. Okay. The same way. And I1, I3, it is not presented in T1. The same combinations, it is not presented in T1. So we marked 0. And I1, I4, it is not presented in T1, so we marked 0. Then I2, I3, which is not presented in T1, we marked 0. I2, I4, all, and I3, I4, both are not presented in T1, so we marked 0, 0. Likewise, The next one we can take first I1, I2. We'll take first again I1, I2. Whether it is presented in T2 or not. No, it is not there. The same combination, it must be there. I1, I2. In T2, we have only I2, I3, I4. Okay, there is no I1. So, I1, I2 combination is not presented in T2, so we marked 0. Okay. The same way, I1, I3, it is not presented in T2, okay, so we marked 0. Okay. So, each and every time, with this base table, we are going to verify the placing of the item set in transactions. Okay. So, with this, we framed this table. Now, we will see the sum of item set. So, in the left side, left to right, if you take T1, it is having only 1, and T2 having 3. The count, I am telling about the count, okay, and T3 having only 1, the last column only having 1, and T4 we have 1 1 1 1 1 1 1, almost 6 we have. But in case of item wise, if you see, the sum will be sum will be for I1, I2 we have 2, and I1, I3 we have 1, then I4 we have 1, then I2, I3 we have 1 1, so 2. Okay, then I2, I4 we have 1 1, so sum will be 2. Then I3, I4 we have sum 1 1 1, so 3 we have. So if you take this T1 and T2, it is given red colors. Okay, the sum is less than the minimum support. Minimum support here we have taken 2. Okay, so the minimum support count is compared with this sum of this transactions. Here we are going to remove T1. Why? Because the T1 sum is 1, and T3 sum is also 1. So both T1 and T2 will be removed. And if you see the item set, I1, I3 is 1, the sum is 1, and I1, I4 sum also 1. Okay, so if you compare these 1, it is less than minimum support. So these two items will also be removed, and finally we'll get the third table, left side down, third table. Okay, here we have only finally T2 and T4, and the item sets are I1, I2, I2, I3, I2, I4, and I3, I4. Okay. So, this is the finalized one. Now, here we have two transactions. The item sets are in two item set combinations we have. Next, we will go for three item set combinations. When you go for three item set combinations, in first column, I1, I2, and the last column, I3, I4, both will not be joined with any items because of property of join operation of a priori. So we have taken the middle two columns, I2, I3, I2, I4. If you join these two columns, we'll get the next table, I2, I3, I4. Okay. So the third table, the left side, if you join the middle two columns, we'll get the fourth column, right side, the fourth column, I2, I3, I4. Now we'll see I2, I3, I4 in the base table, in the T1 transaction, how many times, whether it is occurred or not. It is occurred. Okay. It is available in T2. Okay. So we marked 1 here. The same item set, I2, I3, I4, it is also presented in T4 base table T4. In base table T4 ID transaction, we have I2, I3, I4 also. So here also we marked 1. This is a finalized table, reduced transaction tables. And this is the only qualified and possible item set, frequent item set. Okay. So here is the frequent item set is okay, I2, I3, I4. Even if you find the sum of these items, it is 2. It is equal to minimum support. So this is only possible one. So next method is partitioning method. It is also one of the important method. Any item set that potentially frequent in database must be frequent in at least one of the partition of database. The process which is clearly given in the diagrams. First we will take transaction ID, then divide the transaction ID into n number of overlapping partitions. Then we have two different phases. The phase 1, in phase 1 we'll take find frequent item set local to each partitions. The second one, combine results to form a global set of candidate item set. In phase 2 we have taken global frequent item set among candidate, and finally we have taken frequent item set in database. Okay, now we'll take the table. Okay, so here the data is given, it is a Boolean expressions. Okay, so here is a database. This database is going to be divided into three partitions and each having two transaction support of 20%. The 20% in the sense, okay, so if it is one item, okay, then it must be 1%. Okay, so if it is two, then it will be two. The count must be 2. So with this we'll see, we'll do partitions. Now there are three, I told you there are three partitions. So in the partition method, the base table is divided into three partitions. In the partition method, the partition table, base table, we have six transactions: T1, T2, T3, T4, and T6. So we have six transactions. Three partition will take T1, T2, T3, T4 and T5, T6. If you take these three combination, okay, the base table will be divided into three. So each and every time we have to be very clear about whether this value is going to satisfy the minimum support or not. That is the 20%. If it is item is 1, then the item will be, that the support will be 1. One time it must be presented. If it is 2, two times it must be presented. Here we will see how this table is converted into another form. So here in this table we have transaction ID, item set, first scan, second scan and shortlisted. In the transaction ID we have taken all transaction ID from T1, T2, T3, T4, T5 and T6. Okay, the item set, okay, we are going to take here 2-2. Okay, 2-2 item sets we have taken over here. Okay, so it is given all the item sets here, T1, 2, T5 we have given here. The same item sets we're going to take it over here. Okay, so I1, I5, I2, I4, I4, I5, I2, I3, I5, okay, and I2, I3, I4. Okay, this item set will be taken with the help of there's a Boolean table. Okay, so here if you see this table, the I1 it is presented in T1, okay, and I5 it is presented in T1. So T1 will be I1, I5. The same way in T2, I2 is presented, I4 also presented. So T2 will be I2, I4. And in T3, you can see I4 is presented, I5 also presented. We marked 1, presented in the sense we marked 1. So if we marked 1 means it is available. Okay. In T4 transaction, okay, I2 is marked 1, okay, and I3 also marked 1. So the content of T4 will be okay, I2 and I3. The content of T5 will be I5 alone. The content of T6 will be I2, I3, I4. Okay. So these data will be taken here, item set. T1 contain I1, I5. T2 contain I2, I4. T3 contain I4, I5. T4 ID contains I2, I3 and T5, I5 alone. T6, I2, I3 and I4. Now we'll see the first scan. During the first scan, we'll take T1 and T2. Both will take. Okay. So T1, T2. In T1, T2. Okay. The T1 is occurred one time, and T2 is occurred one time, and T4 is occurred one time, and T5 is occurred one time. Okay. And if you find the combinations, okay, and I1, I5 occurred one time. And I1, I2 occurred, there is no combinations. And I2, I4, this is a combination, it is occurred one time. You know. So, I told you, we have three partitions. The first partition, T1, T2. The second partition, T3, T4. The third partition, T5, T6. Okay. So, according to that, the table is created. Okay. So, here we have three partitions. The same way, in the first scan, we have to identify the item sets. So you can check the value of these two, value of these item sets. Okay. And same way for T3, T4 item set. For T3, T4 transaction, okay, the item set, the partitions, okay, during the first scan, okay, again we have to check. T2 is available here one time. The value of T2 is 1. T3 is 1. And I4 is 1. Then I5 is 1. Then combinations I4, I5 is 1. Then I2, I3 is 1. Okay. The same way T5, T6 partitions. T5, T6 is a third partitions. Here we have T5, I2, I3, I4. If we combine these two, okay, these two, and the occurring will be counted. Okay, in this partition, T5 here itself, T5 is available only one time. Okay, T2 available one time, T3 available one time, T4 available, sorry, I5, I2, I3, I4. All the item sets are here, it is available one time. So the value is given 111. Okay, and if you find the combinations, so that is also given here. I2, I3, okay. I2, I4, I3, I4, and I2, I3, I4. Okay, so completely the combination is given. Then, when you go for second scan, okay, all the partitions can be merged and it can be taken as a single. Okay, so by combining in the results of first scan, we'll be able to get the second scan. Okay. All three partitions item set scan, first scan will be merged and we have taken for second scan. During the second scan, we got some item set. Okay, so the duplicate items will be removed. The remaining items, everything will be taken over here. Okay, so by merging everything, we are getting the final one. Okay, it is second scan. Here the value. Okay, here the value, see here, it is identified white color. Okay, so I1 equal to 1, I1, I5 equal to 1, I4, I5 equal to 1, I2, I3, I4 equal to 1. These are all having count that is less than the minimum support. Okay, so here we have taken the minimum support. If it is 2 transaction, it must be 2. I told you it's a 20%, it must be 2. Okay. So when compare this count with the minimum support, it is less than value. So this white colored identified item sets will be removed and the black colored identified item set will be taken. That is a shortlisted item sets. So like this, by doing partition methods, we can reduce the transaction. Okay, there we have two different scan, okay, first scan and second scan, and three different partitions. So initially here we have taken three different partitions, and slowly it will be merged. Okay, during first scan we have three partitions. Okay, during second scan we merged all. Okay, and from there this item count will be verified with minimum support. If it is less than the minimum support, then those item set will be removed and the remaining item set will be taken. That is a shortlisted item set. Okay, so these are all the three methods we have seen here to improve the a priori algorithms. By improving the a priori algorithm, we'll be able to get shortlisted frequent item set quickly. Okay, so we reduced the number of scan in the database, we improve the performance. Yeah, we reduce the time taken to identify the frequent item set using a priori algorithm. The same a priori algorithm is used. Here we have seen some of the methods to improve the a priori algorithm. Thank you, students. Next class we see the next topic. Okay, thank you.